presents I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the show that's done for comedy, what Richard Gere did for animal husbandry. You join us in the historic town of Brighton, which, before it became the fashionable seaside resort we now know, was once a fishing port. It was in the early 15th century that Arab dhows, plying cargoes of exotic spices along the Red Sea coast and down the Horn of Africa to Zanzibar, were looking for another anthropode to trade minerals and precious stones from white slavers and the great tribes of the Serengeti. Luckily, they discovered Dar es Salaam and so never had to come to Brighton. We're coming to you today as part of the Brighton Festival, and we're broadcasting from the town's lovely old Theatre Royal, which I was interested to learn is haunted. Apparently, eyewitnesses have described grey apparitions. probably long-forgotten performers from a bygone age. Poor souls that could well have died right here on this very stage. Let me point them out to you now. They are... on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. On my right, Willie Rushton and Tim Brooke Taylor. And finally, please welcome the lady with the scorebook, who's very keen to put the team's points in. The delightful Samantha. Well, our first round is entitled Missed Hits. How often have you listened to a new LP and been disappointed that what seemed to have the makings of great songs were ruined by one unfortunate misjudgment in production? Every time we listen to the new Robson and Jerome album, I hear you shout. In this round, teams, I'd like you please to suggest some titles of songs and musical acts that would have been surefire pop chart misses. Barry, will you start us off, please?
The Sound of Silage?
My Old Man's a Waste Disposal Operative.
Mad Dogs and Belgians. Robin Cook, Robin Cook, Robin Cook.
Meet Me in St. Leonard's.
Knees Up Gordon Brown.
The Newt Has a Thousand Eyes.
Arrivederci, Chroma.
By the time I get to Felixstowe.
Conservative Central Office's Land of Hype and Tory.
The Sun Has Got His Pants On.
Andy Stewart's failed hit, D-I-V-O-R-C-U, Jimmy.
Say we're in Hove.
Ah, B-Days are here again.
I'm just a girl who can't say Nice to hear them again, isn't it?
Let's go on to the next round, eh? This is called Celebrity Organs. Oh. This, I should point out, has nothing to do with Noel Edmonds or any other celebrities who just happen to be bodily appendages in their own right. You'll all be familiar with the recent and regrettable trade in internal human organs. Seems for a small sum, I've managed to procure several mystery celebrity organs for your inspection, which Samantha has specially prepared in the two kidney bowls you find in front of you. So I'd like you now, please, to don your surgical masks and gloves. Now, will you please start to identify the...
Can we look at them now, Hong?
Yes. And start to identify them.
Oh,
you've got to identify the celebrities from the organs in front of you. Off you go.
But are they internal organs? I only ask if they're internal because that could be something from Michael Jackson's face.
I think we've got Jeffrey Archer's fourth prostate.
What do you think?
Complete with appendix.
Well, Willie, what do you think?
I don't know. Looks like Michael Winner's spleen.
What's that, Graham?
I don't know what that is. That could be John Virgo's commentator's eye.
Smack it and we'll all get a bit.
Oh, God.
Oh, you've just dropped one of Lady Porter's best bits.
This is pretty heavy, Graham. Can you give me a hand? Something to do with James Hewitt, I think.
For those at home, I should tell you that we actually do have the organs here.
Yes.
And they're being shown to the organ. shown to the audience.
Michael Portillo's heart? No, he can't be. Are these Parker bowels?
Well, as steam rises slowly from the organs in front of them, I think we ought to move on to the next games. What do you think at home, are atmospherics, is really the audience here throwing up. So we go on to a game now.
Oh, it is awful, but I like it.
We'll go on to an old favourite. It's called One Song to the Tune of Another. And it's a musical game that's as simple in concept as the title itself. And let me explain. In most songs, there are two elements, the tune, or music, and the words, or lyrics. Well, in this game, I want the teams to take the lyrics, or libretto, of one song, or composition, and discard the music, or score, and then we'll provide the instrumental, or backing track, from another orchestration, or composition, but without its original refrain, or vocal part. The team should then accompany or syncopate to this melody or harmony. And hey presto. One song to the tune of another. There you are. And if you think that's a total musical mismatch, wait till you hear the combination of Colin Sell and a piano. Actually, Colin has of late become quite well known for his rap music. And when I say rap, I mean rap with a capital C. Graham. Would you start us off, please, by singing the words of 10cc's I'm Not In Love to the tune of I'm Getting Married in the Morning.
Oh, I'm not in love, so don't forget it. It's just a silly phase I'm going through. And just because I call you up, don't get me wrong, don't think you've got it made. I'm not in love, no, no, it's because I like to see you, but then again, that doesn't mean you mean that much to me. So if I call you, don't make a fuss. Hey!
Okay, your turn, Barry, now. And you have to sing the words of Oh, What a Beauty to the tune of The Sunshine of Your Smile.
See one as big as that before. Oh, what a beauty. It must be 2 feet long or even more. It's such a lovely color and nice and round and fat. I never thought a marrow could grow.
Willie, you're going to sing the words of J.J. Cale's Cocaine to the tune of The White Cliffs of Dover.
This should be fun. If you want to hang out, you gotta take her out. Cocaine, if you want to get down, down on the ground. Cocaine, she don't lie, she don't lie, she don't lie, cocaine. If you got bad news, you want to kick them blues, cocaine. When your day is done and you gotta run, cocaine. She don't lie, she don't lie, she don't lie, cocaine. If your thing is gone and you want to ride on.
Finally, Tim, will you please sing the words of Rasputin by Boney M. to the tune of Danny Boy.
Rasputin, a lover of the Russian queen. There was a cat that really was gone. Rasputin, Russia's greatest love machine. It was a shame how he carried on. He ruled the Russian land and never mind the Tsar.
Your glasses,
but vodka, Sasha, he does really wonder now.
Never again.
Thank heavens for the rubber gloves.
Well, I know where they've been.
Okay, with Tim edging into the lead, we have a next round which is called Superstitions, and it's based on those peculiar little irrational fears that we all sometimes have. Tim, for example, believes that it's very bad luck to buy a round of drinks in a pub. And Barry believes it's very unlucky ever to do the washing up. If his wife asks him to do it, apparently he makes her turn round three times and spit. Anyway, team, I shall now put your knowledge of these old wives' tales to the test with a series of my favourite superstitious beliefs and sayings. And we're going to start with you, Barry. Will you please complete the following? See a pin and pick it up. All day long you'll have...
a pin.
How true that is.
I rest my case.
The real answer is good luck, of course. Oh. Graham, can you complete this, I wonder? A dimple on your cheek, many hearts you will seek. A dimple on your chin...
and you'll get to play Spartacus.
Oh. And, of course, the real answer is many hearts you will win. Gosh, that's interesting. Tim, why do some people wear rabbit's feet around their necks?
Probably the same reason that bald people wear rabbits on their heads. Because of the distance, they look like hares.
Well, we all know the right answer to that one.
That was it.
Willie, what in France should you do if you pass a priest on a country road?
Pick it up at once in your priest scooper. They're zealots where that sort of thing's concerned, you know. Little bicycles go around, don't they? Hitting you if you don't.
Do you know what the real answer is? You should touch iron to ward off evil spirits. Barry, you again now. Would you complete this saying? A mole on your arm can bring you no harm. A mole on your back
wants a lift to the lawn.
And an,
how sweet.
Another one for you, Graham, here. A spider in the morning is a sign of sorrow. A spider in the afternoon?
A spider in the afternoon is a sign of poor positional play, leaving the cue ball hampered by the pink.
Or, alternatively, brings worry for tomorrow. Tim, if the cat in your house is black...
Phone the fire brigade. Only probably it's too late.
And the real answer is, of lovers you will have no lack. Willie.
Yes.
Beware of the man, be he friend or brother, whose hair is...
Not his, but that of another.
Well, you know, the real answer is, whose hair is one colour and his beard another.
Oh. No, but... I'm sort of the same all over, aren't I?
No, you're not.
Oh.
Here are some more that you can answer, teams. Why is it good luck to throw salt over your left shoulder?
It gets the mole off your back.
The real answer is that salt was seen as a protective substance and evil spirits were supposed to live on your left side.
Oh.
But I'm not going to explain
that. Now these real answers good.
They are. They're out of a book of superstitions. So there.
Never read a book of superstitions or your bum falls off.
What's supposed to happen if you wear rosemary round your neck?
I think the best answer is you'll have to marry her.
And it upsets the rabbits.
Well, the mole's none too happy.
It says here you'll have a better memory, and I'm not in the least surprised. It's now time for another thoroughly enjoyable game called Cheddar Gorge, which is just one of many traditional pastimes taking their title from English place names. For example, there's Chipping Norton, which involves making stone sculptures in the shape of motorcycles. Then we have Tower Bridge, a card game for exceptionally tall players. And I understand there are still certain isolated rural communities in Lancashire that like to play Upper Ramsbottom. Anyway, as the game Cheddar Gorge so obviously implies, teams, I'd like you each to utter a single word in turn. The object of the game is to avoid completing a sentence and was suggested by a Mr. Ernest Saunders of St. Moritz. To complicate matters further, however, I'd like you each to include a special word indigenous to Brighton and its surrounding coastline. And these are, Barry, your word is nudist. Tim, crabs. Graham, deck chair. And Willie, sewage. And if I judge that a sentence has been completed, you'll hear this. Or I might sound my horn.
The old problem, eh?
Okay, Barry, will you start, please?
I once saw
a
large butt.
Somehow,
strangely
attractive,
yet oddly,
bizarrely,
grotesquely,
and horrendously,
yet
in
a deck chair.
Comma, crabs.
Sounds like a villain in a James Bond book.
Oh, my name is Comma Crabs.
Commander Bond. I am going to punctuate you, Mr. Bond.
Where are we? Common crabs. And?
Don't look at me.
Lobsters?
Not.
Only.
Nudists? Cheated, I said plural there. An intrusive S.
Cavorting?
Lewdly.
Over.
A.
Cliff? Who
was
in
Wuthering mood?
He
was
once
a
crab
like
person until
one
day
he decided
to
try
sewage.
I think strangely attractive butt will be cut out of the American version. Our next round is entitled Antiques Roadshow. You'll guess that this round was inspired by the television program of the same name. And interestingly, Graham has informed me that the presenter, Hugh Scully, is actually the uncle of Agent Scully from the X-Files. Amazing. Teams, in this round, I'd like you please to take it in turns to be antiques experts and members of the public who've brought along an item that they'd like the experts to identify and value. However, only the punters will know what they've brought along. The experts should ask them questions in order to help them identify the items and so value them. Okay, so you're to be our first experts, Tim and Willie. And Barry and Graham, you're the punters. Have you brought your object with you?
We have,
okay,
yes,
right.
We have it with us.
Now, for the benefit of our theatre audience, the identity of Barry and Graham's object will now be displayed via the megabyte magic of the giant computer-generated internet-linked laser display board, so generously funded by the Brighton Festival. Meanwhile, here's the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Rutland. Rutland.
Okay, now, Tim and Willie.
Well, this is incredible. Yeah. How long have you had this?
Oh, how long is it? We found it in the loft, but I can't...
Yeah.
How long has it festered in your loft?
I don't know how long it's been up there. It was put up there, I think, by my Uncle Hugh. Scully.
Have you any sort of idea what it is?
Well, we know generically what it is. We wanted to identify specifically, really.
Yes, and how much we should insure it for.
Well, you can do that by size.
Oh.
It's about a pound a foot. How much have you got?
Several square miles.
Ah. I think you're quite wise to get rid of it, quite frankly.
There is a crack in it, but it doesn't show.
Yes.
Do you have a very large attic?
We have now, yes.
We knocked it through.
Are you implying that all people that go on this show are real Wallys?
Yes.
Some are reproductions.
It hasn't been used for a long time now, of course.
It's the Isle of Wight.
It was discarded, wasn't it?
It was discarded.
Found its way into our loft by a circuitous
route. Yes, people who lived there were most upset.
Hong Kong.
Oh, you can see the pattern on it, can you?
Are there any markings on it?
Signposts, mainly.
One that says R-U-T something. Would you like
that
a clue?
That would be where rutting was allowed.
It doesn't exist anymore, Rutland, does it?
It's coming back. It's coming back.
It is.
Your turn to be the experts now, Barry and Graham and Tim and Willie. I hope you brought your object with you. You have? Right.
Yes. Yes, we have, huh?
Do we have to talk like that?
Apparently so.
Oh, okay.
Its identity is now being broadcast to our audience via the laser display, and here again is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
The latest portrait of the Queen. The latest portrait of the Queen.
Start questioning them, Barry and Graham.
Are there newer reproductions of this, or is this the old original sort
Reproduction no longer enters into it, I'm happy to say.
Obviously an artifact from a bygone era.
Only in one sense of that. It is not strictly an antique.
You mean it's new?
That's a good way of
putting
it. No
getting round you, isn't it?
This century?
This, yes.
This century?
More like 3 weeks ago.
It's one of the freshest antiques on the market.
And it's been in your family all that time,
about a fortnight now. It's being suggested a hand should come off.
How many hands were there?
Just the two. Pairs.
One pair, I think, would be more accurate, one Gilbert. Pair.
I only saw one side of the picture. Oh, oh picture! Oh, what a good one!
Oh, you know all about the subtle hints, don't you?
Right. This looks to me like a picture.
Oh. More like a portrait. Oh! Of the Queen. Ah!
With huge hands, a grim expression.
It's a lovely piece.
Yes. Thank you.
Not a very good picture of her, though.
We've finished, Tom. We've finished. We'll go for a walk on the front later.
We're fast running out of time now, but there are just a few minutes left in which to play a round of Launderette Attendance Film Club. So teams, while Samantha and I drop into Sketch Liz to put some starch into my dicky, I'd like you please to provide some titles of films likely to prove popular with an audience drawn from the laundry trade. Off you go.
Arbitrary.
Everything you ever wanted to know about socks but were afraid to ask.
Dry hard.
Cool wash Luke.
Non-bio east of Java.
The Smalls of Montezuma. Starring Laundry Hepburn and Ariel Flynn.
Some Like It Hot Wash.
On the Bleach.
Bring Me the Vest of Alfredo Garcia. Sink the Skid Mark.
Well, as the little Andrex puppy of time scampers onto the busy dual carriageway of destiny, and the extra strong meat vindaloo of fate confronts the toilet out of order sign of eternity, I notice it must be the end of the show. So from the team, Samantha, myself, and the tanned and muscular residents of Brighton, goodbye.
Timber King, Barry Trial, Graham Garden and Willie Rushton have been given silly things to do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme was produced by John Naismith. We'll be right back.
presents I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue. You join us in the elegant seaside town of Brighton, immortalised in Graham Greene's unmistakable style as the setting for his most widely read novel, Our Man in Havana. Once again, we're guests of the Brighton Festival, a mecca for artists of many disciplines. Indeed, our team members tell me they've been provided with a temporary studio in which to create and display their unique brand of avant-garde sketches, cartoons and poetry. Anyone wishing to view the work is welcome to visit it after the show, but do please remember to knock first as the lock's broken. Please welcome them. They are on my right, Willie Rushton and Tim Brooke Taylor. On my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And please welcome the lady who's here to check that none of our panelists is lagging in the points department, the delightful Samantha. It's always best to start the show off with one of the lighter games, so let's kick off with a round of obituaries. Teams, in this round, I'd like you please to adopt the style and language generally employed by obituary writers to describe the lives of certain famous people, alive or dead. Tim, will you start, please?
Robert Maxwell, his suits were all tailor-made and his knowledge of the law was outstanding. It means he was a fat crook. Allegedly.
A kinder version of Robert Maxwell is a larger-than-life figure who nevertheless took the financial support of his retired employees...
Oliver Reed, star of Liverdance... ...died yesterday... quite near his home. Sadly pissed.
Any more? Okay, well, I'll...
Michael Heseltine died yesterday. He has since denied this. I've got one from The Guardian, Humph, here. In the obituary of Brian McWhinney, published yesterday, the last line should have read, he was a keen countryman and a consummate shot.
The next round is a musical one which also involves the team singing. It's called Pick Up Song, and in it I shall be asking the teams to sing along to a selection of my favourite discs. DJ Samantha has kindly got my reproduction equipment out. And plugged it in. On the front is a large knob which at my command she'll twist firmly in an anti-clockwise direction, causing the volume to drop while the teams are singing along. If on its return the teams are within a tick's crotchet of the original, I'll be awarding points, and points mean Gatwick Airport. What do points mean? Do you know what you just said? I can get him to say anything.
Go on.
Oh, the power of it all. Of course, points mean prizes. And this week's prize is an all-expenses-paid pilgrimage to see England play cricket at Lourdes. And if England aren't all out by lunch, they'll also witness a miracle. Willie, I'd like you to start, please, by accompanying the songstress Millie singing My Boy Lollipop.
My boy
Lollipop, you made my heart go giddy-up. You are as sweet as candy. You're my sugar dandy. Oh, My Boy Lollipop. Never, ever leave me. Because it would, she used to have gold teeth, rows and rows. My heart told me so.
I love you, I love you, I love you so. But I want you to know, I just found a sweet in my pocket. I need you, I need you, I need you so. And I'll never let you go. Oh, my boy, Lollipop. You make my heart go giddy up.
Oh, my boy.
Oh, you it's slow, Mill.
Your turn, Graham. See if you can do better than that. I'd like you please to accompany Suggs in his very contemporary rendition of Cecilia.
Cecilia, you're breaking my heart. You're shaking my confidence daily. Oh, Cecilia, I'm down on my knees. I'm begging you please to come home. Cecilia, you're breaking my heart. You're shaking my confidence daily. Oh, Cecilia, I'm down on my knees. I'm begging you please to come home. Come on home. Making love in the afternoon with Cecilia up in my bedroom. Making love. I got up to wash my face. When I come back to bed, someone's taken my place. Cecilia, you're breaking my heart.
And never missed a beat. Amazing. Barry, would you please accompany the Righteous Brothers singing Unchained Melody?
Oh, my love. My darling. I've hungered for your touch a long, lonely time.
He's not been well.
Time goes by so slowly, and time can do so much.
Time, gentlemen, please.
Are you still mine?
We're not running a nightclub.
I need your love. I need...
Not far!
Finally, Tim, I'd like you now please to accompany Liam Gallagher of the rock combo Oasis singing Don't Look Back in Anger.
Slip inside the eye of your mind, don't you know you might find a better place to play. You said that you'd never speak of the things that you've seen. So is that a revolution from my bed? Cause you said the brains I had went to my head. Step outside as summertime's in bloom. Stand up beside the fireplace. Take that look from off your face. You ain't ever gonna burn my heart out.
Sit down, Miss Pennington.
Tune coming up. And so Sally can wait. She knows it's too late as we're walking on by.
Oh, just
my God.
How those boys do it every night, I don't know.
And sing.
Okay. The next round is called Sound Charades, and it's based on that wonderful old parlor game, Charades. In our version, the teams will take it in terms to enact the title of a well-known film, book, or TV program for the opposing team to guess. And since we're on the radio, they'll be using a form of verbal... Barry and Graham, you're to start, and your title will shortly be broadcast to our theater audience via the laser display board for Tim and Willie to guess. Meanwhile, here's the mystery voice for listeners at home.
They think it's all over. They think it's all over.
Okay, now is it a book, or a film, or what?
It's neither of those. It's a TV program.
Ah.
Five words, and we'll do it all at once.
Ugh.
It's nice out, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
Yeah, that girl over there, hasn't she?
What? What about her?
She's got a lovely tan, hasn't she?
Oh, gorgeous.
You know, I reckon she's been sunbathing nude.
You what?
Yeah.
Yeah, nah, leave it out.
I bet there's no white patches, I bet.
Gaw. Really?
That's what I reckon.
Well.
Well. Better believe it.
How do they do that?
That is quite excellent.
Yeah. Very, very good guess, but totally wrong.
Fantasy football leg.
Hasn't got anything.
Oh, that's in the right area, fantasy football
yes.
leg.
Yeah.
Oh. Football.
Well.
Oh, football-ish.
Football-ish. Mm. Cricket.
Footballing links.
Is it somebody who presents it? Is that the link? No.
No.
Well,
there are people on the pitch.
People on the pitch. They think it's all over.
Oh.
And I wish it was all over. Right, it's your turn now, Tim and Willie. Your title's going up on the laser display. And here again is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
12 Angry Men. 12 Angry Men.
Okay, what is it?
Three words. It's a film and a play. God, I'm furious.
I'm bloody angry myself. I don't know means you're crying.
Talk about injustice.
I've had it up to...
Outrageous.
Bloody awful.
Dreadful.
God, the wrath. I feel wrathful. I am ire packed. Well, what does a 12th man think?
Shoot, don't.
Don't talk to me about it. I've never been so insulted in the whole... I'm sorry. All right, back to your cages.
The end.
There was a clue there. The 12th man. It must have been conversation in the England cricket pavilion.
No. Of a judicial nature.
You can tell when Barry's got it.
Yeah, we've got it, hon. Next.
Well, you better say what it is, I suppose.
12 monkeys. Men.
Right, our next round is entitled Psychics, and the idea... our next round is entitled Psychics, and the idea for it came to us...
I knew you were going to say that.
He's going to say it again. Spooky.
Our next round is entitled Psychics. And the idea for it is...
Don't mock the spirits.
I'm going to take a run at it this time.
Where have I heard that before?
Silence. Our next round is entitled Psychics, and the idea for it came to us while we were all watching Mystic Meg on the television the other day. Quite suddenly, a very spooky thing happened. We all mysteriously knew exactly what each other was thinking. And the thought was, what a load of rubbish. In this round, the team should take it in turns to be psychics and to divine by mental powers alone precisely what the others are thinking. And there'll be a bonus point for anyone able to guess what I'm thinking. Okay, Tim and Willie, will you start by telling us, please, what Barry and Graham are thinking, plus anything else of interest you managed to glean from the spirit world?
I'm getting... Mary. I'm getting traffic news from Geronimo. Avoid the little bighorn.
Barry, do you have Welsh blood or are you interested in sheep generally?
I've bought a kilt because they've learned to recognise the sound of a zip.
Barry and Graham, it's your turn. Concentrate and tell us what Tim and Willie are thinking.
Well, Willie's been drawing there. Just keep on with that drawing, Willie, and project it to me, and I'll try and copy it here.
Ooh, that's really okay, good.
Right. And just concentrate really hard. This may not work. Okay, Willie, now...
I'll tell you why it's not working. I'll stop drawing.
So just tell me, what was your drawing?
It was a strange sort of doodle. It's just a sort of hole in a cube.
And so was mine.
It's true, listeners.
I tell you what. People often ask our team members, where can I see your latest show? To which they reply, on UK Gold.
Too true to be funny.
Well, watching that channel the other evening with its non-stop reruns of the same old tired formats, I started to think about this show and how exciting it might be to try something fresh and original. So, teams, I've had a brand new round commissioned. It's called Odd One Out. What else would you call a round that's fresh and original? Coincidentally, Odd One Out is also the object of the game. And in case you haven't realized it, I've moved on from the psychic game. You'll hear a selection of recordings, teams, and your task is to tell which is the odd one out and why. We're going to start with you, Barry. Could you please explain which is the odd one out from the following?
Archers, status quo, Coronation Street, that last noise, knees knocking, I think that was. Someone who wears short skirts and inclement weather. Knees knocking. Paulie Yates. I've got it. They've all been together a long time except Paulie Yates' knees.
Your turn, Willie, now. Could you please identify the odd one out here?
Diese Deutschen sind von ihnen als Geschöpfe Gottes. Der Allmächtige hat sie nicht geschaffen.
Away goes De Freitas, passes John Hampshire Burles. Jarosier, it's cuts up one for four.
Shot the ball, carry near. The Lord has spoke together there, the caution of a steer.
That was a Swedish pop song. Jonas, Chancellor Cole. A cat. Perhaps, oh, I know, this wasn't... this is interesting, yes. Because Kerimir had a ball. Jonas was describing a ball, because he wasn't in any way unitesticular. And Hitler, as the song had it, only had one, didn't he? But our cat hasn't got any.
So you're saying the cat was the odd one out?
Yes, I am.
Oh, good. Graham, can you tell us...
Willie calls a spade a spade.
Graham, can you tell us, please, which of the following... I'll pretend I didn't hear that. I don't have to pretend I didn't hear it. Graham, please, can you tell us which of the following is the odd one out and why?
Siesti,
What every author tries to do when reading through a book is get rid of coincidence. It's coincidence that's unacceptable in a novel. I'll give you a small example. When Mary and I were up in London, going...
Graham?
Fine tenor there. That was probably Pavarotti, wasn't it, at the beginning? Followed by a saxophone. I'm not sure who was playing it. So we've got a tenor singing, a saxophone, and then Geoffrey Archer. And then a burp. So I think it's all but one of these sounds is made by the mouth.
Finally, Tim, which is the odd one out of these noises?
Every girl dreams of the ideal man with whom she will fall in love. My dream lover has always been tall, dark, handsome, cynical and disillusioned with life, until he meets me. Dream lover.
That last one was, well, it's now an ex-lobster. I think the answer is pink. They're all pink. That was rosé wine, bacon sizzling, and Barbara Cartland. They're all, no. No, I know what it is. The bacon, the lobster, and the wine all have exceptional taste.
Well, our next round is based on a novel entertainment called Stars in Their Eyes, where hopeless amateurs dress up badly and try to make it in the world of television, otherwise known as Dixons. Our version is called Stars in Their Ears. In it, our teams will try to convince the audience that they're well-known celebrities. They should be. Rather less convincing will be Colin Sell's impression of a piano player. Incidentally, I've been reading in the festival press that there was a bit of a stir at an afternoon performance of Beethoven's piano sonatas in the Dome. Apparently, just after the Appassionata, concertgoers were amazed to hear Colin Sell's Allegro. They said if he must race it round the car park, he could at least get the exhaust fixed. So I'd like each of you, please, to sing a song in the style of a famous person of my choosing. Willie, you're going to start. I'd like you to sing Jerusalem in the style of Eartha Kitt.
And it was these in ancient times, and the baby walk upon England's mountains.
Orson Welles here. I've been quoted as saying, Eartha was the sexiest woman in the world. Probably the silliest thing I ever said.
And hide her down the chimney tonight.
I don't quite know what you were doing then, so I can't mark that at all. What was he doing?
Lost. He went into Orson Welles halfway through.
Sorry, just a minute. Who are you?
Who's next, Hump?
Tim.
Hello.
Would you please sing How Much Is That Doggy in the Window as Jeremy Paxman?
You're start for 10. How much is that doggy in the window? You know the one I'm talking about, the one with the waggly tail smear. How much is that doggy in the window? Aren't I gorgeous? I do hope that dog is for sale. I must take a trip to California, that's in America, and leave my boss alone. If he has a dog, he won't be lonesome. And the doggy will have a good home. I'm started, so I'll finish. God, this is easy.
Barry, will you please sing Hey Good Looking in the style of Andy Kershaw?
I heard this version by the Bundu boys, and when we trips over there, I'd like to do it for you. Hey, good looking, what you got cooking? How's about cooking something up with me? Turned out nice again. Hey, good looking, what you got cooking? How's about cooking something up? How's about cooking something up? How's about cooking something up with me, the Bundu boys? Unbelievable. See you next week.
Okay. Graham, will you please sing As Time Goes By in the style of Frank Butcher, off of EastEnders?
You must remember this, Pat. A kiss is still a kiss. A sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental things apply as time goes by. And when two lovers woo, they still say, I love you. On that you can rely. Now listen to me, darling. No matter what the future brings, as time goes by, moonlight and love songs never out of date. Hearts full of passion, jealousy and hate. Woman needs a man. A man must have his mate. That no one can deny if they know what's good for them. Still the same old stories. Fight for love and glory, a case of do or die. The world will always welcome lovers as time goes by.
Well, it's nearly time to end the show, but not before we've played a quick round of Furniture Maker's Songbook. So, teams, while Samantha pops out to French polish her tall boy, I'd like you please to suggest some titles of songs likely to prove popular with a congregation of furniture and cabinet makers. Willie, will you start, please?
Nearly the Elephant's Foot Umbrella Stand.
Or you could have the Chippendales dancing to the Carpenter's Greatest Hits, sung by Cher.
Don't laugh at me, because I'm a stool.
Give Three Peace a chance.
Have you noticed the puppet on a string starts armchair, 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 armchair?
You could have IKEA and Tina Turner. singing River Deep MFI.
Bohemian Flap Settee by Queen Anne.
You could do the shelf song. I'll put you up where you belong.
G Planet Suite by Gustav Upholstery.
Well, as the Plastic Duck of Destiny has been sunk by the loofah of fate, and old Father Time has gone wrinkly in the bathwater of eternity, it must be time to pick out the short hairs of hope from the plug hole of infinity and say goodbye. So from Samantha, the teams, myself, and the fine Festival of Brighton, goodbye.
Barry Trier, Graham Garden and Willie Rushton have been given Silly Things to Do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme was produced by John Naismith.
I'm sorry I haven't a clue. The antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton. Yeah.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the show that attracts laughter like bees round a magnet. We've travelled today to the delightful town of Richmond, so it's only fitting that I should bid a champion Ayoop and an E-bar groom on Milky Mall bar to all our listeners in Yorkshire who can't be with us here in Surrey. It was Henry Tudor, Earl of Richmond, who gave the place its name and chose it as the location for the first great royal palace on a site now famous as the place where Henry VIII had his magnificent Hampton Court. Visitors also delight in Richmond's quaint Old Deer Park, and I notice a small group of quaint old deer has wandered in tonight, and they are on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. On my right, Willie Rushton and Tim Brooke Taylor. And please welcome tonight our stand-in scorer, a man who's got more spare beefcake than Douglas Hogg, the delightful Sven. We'll start off with a round called Translations. It's come to my attention, teams, that many unintelligible foreign words have managed to find their way into our English language, often impeding clear communication. Our scorer Sven, himself a foreigner, is the first to admit that it can often be highly irritating to the more sensitive ear when alien tongues are allowed to slip in. So, teams, I'd like you to provide translations into plain English, please, of the following foreign words and phrases. Graham, we'll start with you. Will you please translate Belle Epoque?
That's a cheap cut of pig meat, isn't it? Give me a pound of Belle Epoque.
Barry, yours is apparatchik.
That's a cross between a parrot and a chick. It does impressions of Colonel Sanders. Start easy, slow.
Willie, here's yours. Sushi.
This is Eddie Cantor's best-known song after the drink got him. If you knew sushi like I know sushi.
And Tim, here's another one for you. Sick transit Gloria Mundi.
Gloria was sick in the van, but she'll be in on Monday. Thank you.
Right, we'll open this one up. Here's one for that any of you can answer. Film noir.
My camera's bust.
How about this? Cinquecento.
100-year-old Chinaman.
Magnum opus.
Oh, now he is the Irish cat, Private Eye. Magnum opus.
And how about Et tu, Brute?
Blimey, you've splashed it all over now. Gov.
Teams, I'm pleased to point, and audience too, I'm pleased to point out to interested listeners, so I hope both of them are paying attention, that after the sad demise of Sven's popular touring troupe, the Chippendales, they've now reformed to appeal to an older, more sedentary audience. I understand they're now accepting work as a male voice choir called the Queen's Singers, And Sven appears to have brought them with him here tonight, so I've suggested they might like to assist him with the score. So, when you're ready, lads.
26 years.
Thank you. It's now time for a long-established round called One Song to the Tune of Another, in which the team sing one song to the tune of another. We've certainly had some sticky moments with this round over the years. Last week, Barry sang an Andrew Lloyd Webber song to the tune of Puccini, and nobody could tell the difference. Anyway, I'm assured that piano accompaniment is required for this round, and it appears that Colin Sell is unexpectedly available to provide it. You know, whenever musicians hear that Colin's working with us, they're always very keen for news of the old maestro. Well, sadly, it's failed its MOT again. So he's had to come on his bike. Graham, I'd like you to start by singing the words of There Ain't Nobody Here But Us Chickens. to the tune of Release Me.
There ain't nobody here but us chickens. There ain't nobody here at all. So quiet yourself and stop the fuss. There ain't nobody here but us.
Take me in.
We chickens trying to flee, and you bust in and hobble, 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 hobble with your chickens. There ain't nobody here but us chickens. There ain't nobody here at all.
Your turn, Tim, and I'd like you, please, to sing the words of Any Old Arm to the tune of Rule Britannia. Willie, you're going to sing the words of I Shot the Sheriff to the tune of My Favorite Things.
With luck.
I shot the sheriff, but I didn't shoot the deputy. All around in my hometown, they're trying to track me down. They say they want to bring me in guilty for the killing of the deputy, for the life of the deputy. But I say, I shot the sheriff, but I say it was in self-defense. I shot the sheriff, and they say it is a capital offense. Sheriff John Brown always hated me for what I don't know. Every time that I plant a seed, he said, kill it before it grows. He said, kill it before it grows. I say, shot the sheriff. I say, self-defense.
And finally, Barry. Barry, would you please sing the words of How Much Is That Doggy in the Window to the tune of Swanee?
How much is that doggy in the window, the one with the waggly? How much is that doggy in the window? I do hope that doggy's for sale. I must take a trip to California and leave my poor sweetheart alone. If he has a doggy, won't be lonesome, and the doggy will have a good day, Mammy. Ah.
Jolly good. Now, the next round is entitled Straight Face. In it, the team should take it in turns to exchange a random selection of words without getting any laughs from our theatre audience. This, I'm assured, is a very specialised skill which our panellists have each managed to hone throughout their long and varied careers in the entertainment business. So to complicate it a little, I'd like all the words you select, teams, to begin with the letter S. Anyone who elicits so much as the smallest titter from our audience will face immediate disqualification. The object of the game is to eliminate all four of them so we can get on with the next round. Graham, will you start, please?
Stomach.
Saucer.
Silent.
What?
Silent.
Oh. Diction.
Doesn't begin with an S.
No, S.
Sherbet is silent. Sherbet, I think he said.
Sorry?
Sherbet?
No, that was my word.
Sorry.
Oh.
Slap.
Salivate.
Sugar.
Then.
Can you have proper words, Hump?
What?
No. Never mind. Sarcophagus.
Surreptitiously.
Swedishly.
Ah!
The old master got a titter.
I heard a laugh, yes. You're out.
Thank you.
Willie.
No,
now, the rest of you go on in sequence, so it would be Graham, you to carry on.
Stew.
Spotted.
Silage.
Yeah, I'm sorry, Barry.
Oh.
That's not the first laugh he's got with silage.
Okay, it's between you.
Is it me? Stop.
It's a header. Blimey. It's a head-to-header between Barry, between Tim and Graham. And Tim, you're going to start.
Sandwich.
Soap.
Slot. Please, come on. Even my mother wouldn't laugh at that.
Your mother doesn't live in Richmond. Slots may not be funny in Buxton, but there.
Go on, Graham.
Smack, smack.
That's a good one.
Smack. Yes. Yeah.
Suffering.
Saucy.
Slip.
That wasn't a laugh.
No. Somebody blowing his nose.
We sincerely hope. Snot.
And with that knockout blow, Graham wins the round. Now we come to a round called Radioke, which is basically a radio version of karaoke, except that at no point does anyone have to lie in a hospital bed worrying that the TV script they've just written is becoming a nightmarish reality. What happens is this. I brought with me some bootleg radio highlights, which I've illicitly recorded off my wireless at home, and I shall play them in for the teams to speak along with. After a while, the tape will fade away to nothing, but the team should carry on speaking, and the object is for them to be in sync when the sound returns. So, Tim and Willie, we'll start with you, and will you please speak along with John Humphreys and Douglas Hogg in this extract from the Today programme.
Good morning to you.
Good morning to you.
Good morning,
you.
Good morning.
That's been it's been difficult, and
something has happened less fast than we would have wished.
But I don't accept it as going to be a mess.
Well, we are slaughtering thousands of perfectly healthy cows, we don't know how many. Farmers are losing a fortune, it's costing the taxpayer billions, we're at war with Europe,
and it's only been a bit difficult.
This is an extremely difficult situation, which has caused a great deal of loss to a lot of people. I entirely agree with you.
Well, no, I mean more than that. I mean, it's been a very badly mishandled situation.
There, I don't agree with you. I think it would have been difficult to handle it fundamentally different from that which we have done. Whether in the last 3 months or so there are things we could have done differently, I'm sure the answer is yes.
Sorry, I wasn't listening.
Well, we're not going to play that game either.
Well, you can volunteer it.
No. I'm merely making this point that over a 3 months' conduct of policy, you will find things that one could have done differently.
But we've done it wrongly right from the very beginning, haven't we? I mean, we stood there, we had a Secretary of State standing up in the House of Commons saying that there is this problem, and clearly no one has given a moment's thought on the repercussions of it or how it might be handled.
That isn't true. We knew it was going to have a very serious effect on confidence in the United Kingdom and Europe. Our problem was this.
What have you got? Do you think there's a problem with your own position?
Now, a look at the weather.
What happened then? Did you win?
Quite frankly, I think Douglas Hogg entered my body and took over.
some strange way, we were as one.
It's your turn now, Barry and Graham, and I'd like you please to speak along with Simon Pemberton and Shula Archer. In this extract from The Archers.
Simon, for heaven's sake,
you've got
to let me talk to you. Come in, why don't you?
Not fair.
No,
fair.
Let me say my piece. My piece. Let it stay quietly. I'm sorry. You wouldn't believe the day I've had. It's like a conspiracy. I tried phoning all evening, but you weren't in.
I've just been practically
ejected from the ball. Simon, this is an attempt to make me feel sorry for you. I'm not in the mood. Simon, we're out of sync.
Look, this Harriet thing. You have to believe me, Shula. It was an affair, but I finished it.
I have nothing to say, Simon.
What, but why? Look, I said I'm sorry. I've told her to stay out of my life. I don't see what more I can do.
That's not the point.
Well, what is then?
The point is, I can't trust you.
Of course you can trust me. You have to understand. This thing was out of my control.
Oh, for goodness sake. You betrayed me with another woman. Look, now is not the time for this. I really think you'd better go.
I'm not leaving until we've had this out.
Oh!
I don't see it. I don't see it. As a betrayal.
We've all seen it. Oh, Simon! How can you not see it as a betrayal?
It's not even as if you and I were sleeping together, for goodness sake. Maybe if we had been, I wouldn't have gone and slept with Harriet.
How dare you! I want you out of my house and out of my life.
Why won't you listen?
Now!
No!
Oh!
Oh, I'm sorry.
Just... Get out!
I'm sorry.
Right, on with the next round. It's recently come to my attention, teams, that many films and TV programs are riddled with commercial sponsorship, placing a question mark against the professional integrity of those prepared to compromise their art for the sake of personal gain. So in this round, which I'd like to call the Volvo 985R Master's Plan, I'd like you teams to enact some newly sponsored productions in a style that reflects their revised status. Tim and Willie, we'll start with you. Would you please provide a brief rendition of Gardener's Question Time, as sponsored by Yorkshire Water?
Good bloody evening. Welcome to Leeds and Gardener's Question Time. First question, please.
I'd like to ask the panel how I should deal with my interinums. They look a little sad. Should I water them?
No.
Days, the Welsh have their leek, the Scots their thistle, and the Irish, oh, it's the same man again, have their shamrock. What would the panel recommend for Yorkshire Day?
A cactus. I thought you were a woman.
I don't know. What would you recommend for a perfect garden?
A mixture of sand and cement, mixing a good deal of cheap white wine or Yorkshire bitter.
Oh, I bathe in that. Oh. In the final analysis, what would you suggest I do?
Vote Labour or emigrate.
Good night.
Bugger off.
All right.
Right, it's your turn, Barry and Graham. Would you please provide an excerpt from The 101 Dalmatians, as sponsored by the Korean government?
One down.
And finally... how I love those words. Tim and Willie, would you please provide an extract from Oscar Wilde's The Importance of Being Earnest, as sponsored by McDonald's?
Welcome to The Importance of Being Ronald.
A hamburger.
Thank you.
Our next round is based on the TV program called Through the Keyhole, presented by Lloyd Grossman, in which the viewer is introduced to the homes of various celebrities and then has to work out who they are. In fact, it's quite similar in format to Hello magazine. But slightly less challenging, of course. In order to allow us to play this game on the radio, the Richmond Theatre stage crew have specially created two mystery cubicles backstage for our teams to enter. They are each designed to resemble precisely the homes of certain well-known personalities. And the team should take it in turn to describe the contents of their cubicle for the other team to guess. Right, Barry and Graham, you're to go first. And I'd like you to enter your mystery cubicle now. While you're on the way, the famous householder's name will now be flashed up in Technicolor magic on the multi-screen laser projection tower so generously provided by our hosts. John brings on board. Oh, sorry. I wasn't meant to read that, but here's the, for the you at home, here's the mystery voice.
Alan Clark. Alan Clark.
Okay, now, Barry and Graham, you're going to describe now, and Willie and Tim, you're going to guess.
Well, it's a lovely room.
Yes, very grand.
Yes.
Haven't seen a microwave with a drawbridge before.
Oh, look there, the shelf full of diaries. Under lock and key.
Oh, I see.
Well, no, no, wait. There's one out here on the desk. Let's see, but ow! Too hot to handle.
Too hot, that. Oh, nice picture here. Look, nice family group.
Oh, yeah.
I think it's been signed.
Yeah, what's it say?
You bastard.
Now, that's something you don't see every day. A Michael Heseltine dartboard.
Good Lord, what's this? A hit of 12. Good. Well, I think we've certainly painted a picture there, Graham.
We have.
Tim and Willie, are you going to do any guessing?
Nope. I don't think so.
Right.
I lost interest halfway through, tell the truth. I suddenly realised what it must be like to be a listener to this programme.
Drawbridge. This is a grand person, is it? Or is it a political person?
A political person.
Or an ex-political person?
Yes. I think it's that bloody woman.
I think it is. Yes. The mad cow, isn't it?
Yes.
No, it's not. Ah, you're trying to mislead us. A packet of 12.
It's her husband.
Yep.
The packet of 12, was it?
No, what to handle. Yeah. Heseltine was on the dartboard. What was he doing there? He was up to somebody that doesn't like
him. Is Alan Clark, by any chance?
No.
He goes as the chemist. It's a gross for the weekend, I think.
Okay, your turn, Tim and Willie.
All right.
Would you go and enter your mystery cubicle now, please? And here again is the laser projection tower with the answer and the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Major James Hewitt. Major James Hewitt.
Well, right. The problem is you don't know where to start, do you? And you can't see anybody. Here we are. We're in the hall now. Good Lord, a stuffed horse's umbrella stand. That's an interesting place to house an umbrella.
Horsehair sofa. Photos of people playing polo. Photos of horses playing polo.
Polo-necked horses.
Oh, and a dog. I think he must be lost.
And wall-to-wall horse brasses. Just go upstairs.
To the bedroom.
Yes.
Horse blankets. And in the bed, a horse's head.
Not just the head, sorry.
That's right. Clothes of the horse.
The wooden horse.
Bath in the shed of the horse.
Oh, look, there's a photograph of Princess Di. Horses, 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 horses. Well, David, what sort of person lives in a horse like that?
Barry and Graham, start guessing.
Were horses a clue?
No. One's allowed to lie once, I believe, in this game.
There's one dog in there.
The dog is one dog. The dog is a red herring. Oh, red setter, probably more accurate.
There's a royal connection here,
yeah.
I would think.
And the audience all went, ooh, when they saw the name on the scoreboard.
Is he a bit of a scally? Bit of a lad. Ooh. James Hewitt.
Yeah!
Well, I'm going to invite the male voice choir to provide another update of the score.
Since the last guard is free, Cardiff City near.
Well, that's very nearly all for this week, but there's just time, I think, for a quick round of Fashion Designers Film Club. So while Sven nips out to press his favourite Paul Smith, I'd like you teams to suggest some titles of films likely to prove popular with the fashion trade. Tim, how about you starting?
Bus stop. They get worse, so just laugh at that one.
Armani in Havana.
How about Dad's Armani?
Armani for all seasons.
Or another TV spin-off, Yes, Miniskirt. Ben Kingsley as Gucci.
Picnic at Hanging Frock.
The Fly.
For whom the bell bottoms.
Night dress on Elm Street. Bring me the measurements of Alfredo Garza.
Champion, the Wonder Bra.
I'd like to see that.
Sleeveless in Seattle.
Well, as the wheelie bin of time is hoisted aloft by the dustman of fate, and the broken eggshells of despair are scattered down the front path of destiny, it must be time to regret not tipping him better. And also the end of the show. So from Zen, the teams and myself, goodbye.
Tim Taylor, Barry Trier, Graham Gardner, and Willie Rushton have been given Silly Things to Do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme was produced by John Naismith.
I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, or as it's officially known to the British Anagram Society, More Unlive Hairy Cats. Once more, we're coming to you from the splendid theatre in the historic London borough of Richmond, whose fine Regency terraces were once home to such theatrical and literary luminaries as David Garrick, Edmund Kean, George Eliot and Virginia Woolf. But Richmond today isn't just about famous names and fashionable celebrities, believe you me. Let's meet the teams. They are on my right, Willie Rushton and Tim Brooke Taylor. And on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And would you please welcome our scorer? He's a well-built young man from Sweden, who's ably assisted by an attractive male voice choir of his acquaintance. Please welcome the very rippling Sven.
Our first round is entitled Historical Headlines. Long ago, in the mists of prehistory, long before the advent of newspapers, topical events were recorded on the walls of caves. One can well imagine how primitive man might have hurried past gruesome paintings of saber-toothed tigers savaging dodos on the first wall and turned instead to admire a fine pair of mammoths on wall three. In this round, James, I shall provide you with a historical event, and I'd like you please to suggest some examples of the newspaper headlines likely to have been printed in the papers the following day. And the event is King Henry VIII splits with Rome. Tim, will you start, please?
Well, the Independent, straight to the point, headline is Henry VIII splits with Rome. Guardian, Henry VII splits with Rome.
The Daily Mail, Anne Boleyn's cellulite shock horror.
Telegraph, King rejects papal bull, gelatine and tallow.
The Daily Mail, Why the King Was Wrong by Paul Johnson on pages 8 and 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15.
Melody Maker, Greensleeves composer on top of the Pope's.
The Stage, Jane Seymour says, stuff this, I'm off to the States to star in the soap.
The Daily Express, spot the head competition.
The Daily Telegraph, Lord Chancellor determined to make divorce easier.
Hello?
The London Evening Standard, tube strike off.
Okay, we come now to a popular round called Pick Up Song. In this round, teams, DJ Sven will toss some choice 12 inches onto my gramophone for each of you to sing along to. Then, by means of some deft adjustments to my volume control, didn't think I was going to say that, did you? He'll ensure that the music fades away while you're still singing. If, on the music's return, you're within an ant's kneecap of the original, I'll be awarding points. I can't be bothered to say what... I can't be bothered to say what points mean, but you can shout it if you like. This week's prize combines great-looking hair with the exhilaration of the Canadian outdoors. It's this hair-styling moose. Barry, we'll start with you. Would you please accompany the Platters singing Only You?
Only you can make this world seem right. Only you can make the darkness bright. Only you and you alone can thrill me like you do.
Taking it seriously.
Fill my heart with love for only you.
Turned out nice again.
That's better.
Only you. And now James Cagney can make this change in me.
Nowhere near. Absolutely rotten.
Such glee you say that, Rick.
Your turn, Graham. I'd like you to accompany Sam Cooke singing Wonderful World.
Don't know much about history. Don't know much biology. Don't know much about a science book. Don't know much about the French I took.
but I do know that I love you. And I know that if you love me too, what a wonderful world this would be.
Get out now, she
gets. Don't know much about geography. I don't know much trigonometry. Don't know much about algebra. Don't know what a slide rule is for. But I do know one and one is two.
Hey, Mother.
That wasn't any good either. Okay, your turn, Tim. Would you please accompany the Ink Spots singing We Three?
We three, we're all alone, living in a memory. My echo, my shadow, and me.
You all know this one?
We three, we're not a crowd, we're not even company. My echo, my shadow, and me. What good is the moonlight, the silvery moonlight that shines above?
Got plans for Christmas?
I walk with my shadow, I talk with my echo.
Look.
Where is the one I shadow? Lord, I know.
Where were you?
Willie.
What?
Would you please accompany the Doily Cart Opera Company singing Model of a Modern Major General?
I'm very good at integral and differential calculus. I know the scientific names of beings, animalculus. But still, it matters vegetable, animal, and mineral. I am the very model of a modern vegetable. Still, it matters vegetable, animal, and mineral.
Our next game is called Sound Charades and is derived from the erstwhile TV program Give Us a Clue. That show, you may recall, involved a game in which the participants were not allowed to speak and employed great imagination to create much laughter and hilarity. As the teams here are allowed to speak, our version differs in that one respect. And for obvious reasons, it differs in the other two as well. So, teams making use of nothing but your verbal dexterity, I'd like you please to take it in turns to enact the title of a well-known film, book, or TV program for the opposing team to guess. Tim and Willie, you're to start, and your title will shortly be broadcast to our theatre audience via the laser projector for Barry and Graham to guess. Meanwhile, here's the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Zulu. Zulu.
Okay.
It's one word.
And it's a film. It's commencing now. excuse me. Excuse me, I wondered if you could just...
Yes. Turn left at the Elephant House.
Yes.
Cross the zebra. On past the pelican. And it's third on your right.
Oh, thank you very much indeed.
The end.
Directions in a zoo, but one word.
There isn't a new blockbuster out called Whipsnade, is
there? Sounds terrific.
I'd like to see it.
Does the syllable zoo appear in the one word?
Yes, it does.
You've got it, haven't you?
No.
What's the one place you
find that you're looking for.
I thought it came out of my performance as I was a man with crossed legs.
Zulu. Zulu.
Right, it's your turn now, Barry and Graham, and your title's going up on the laser projector. And here again is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Groundhog Day. Groundhog Day.
What? On what it was now.
It's a film, and it's two words.
Well, you know, we can't have that fool flying all over there all the time, can we?
Doing the beef industry no good at all.
No good at all. We've got to stop him.
Well, take his passport away.
How to do it, yes. But today's the day we do it.
Well, that's obvious.
Yes.
Is that BSE one word or three?
Today, is today important in this
sounded tremendously important. Yeah.
Take his, was it license away or?
I didn't hear, I wasn't listening.
Take his passport away.
Take his passport away.
Yes.
Passport.
Stop him flying
Stop
around.
Him.
Stop him flying. Wingless.
Ground him.
Ground. Ground Hog Day.
Ground Hog Day, you little shrimp. Ground Hog Day.
At this point, I'd like to invite Sven and the male voice choir to provide the score.
27 for the weekend before lunch.
Okay, our next round is called Any Questions. In this round, I shall be testing our team's general knowledge with a series of questions posed by listeners. We've had quite a few queries in the mail room, and Sven has been working his way through them in order to pull them. How could you possibly guess what I was going to say? In order to pull out the least easy one. Okay, teams, let's see what he's come up with. Graham, I'll put the first one to you. Do spiders have ears?
If you really care, Humph, there was actually a famous experiment proving that they have ears in their legs. Because if you made a loud noise, a spider will run away. But if you pull its legs off...
Well, actually, you've come so close to the right answer that... Because, as you well know, Graham, you were trying to put it... I'll put it more concisely than you did. What are we talking about? Spiders do have very sensitive hairs on their legs. Isn't that interesting? Now, Willie, why, when someone is in danger of being hit by a golf ball, do golfers shout four?
Because the ball has usually struck the victim before they can finish saying, for what it's worth, you're about to be struck by a golf ball.
The real answer is, it's just short for before. Or
it's
look
long
out.
For before, isn't it? Why not just say buh?
What had Archimedes discovered when he leapt from his bath shouting, Eureka?
The hot tap.
Or the loofah. Not very close to him. I'll read you the real answer. When Archimedes stepped into the bath, the water level rose. What a filthy beast.
You know. It's only a
no,
step
suddenly
away.
He suddenly
was sink.
Timing team. No, he suddenly realized that the displacement of water would help him measure the difference between a given volume of gold and that of a mixture of gold and a lesser metal.
That'd be the plug, would it?
Finally, Barry, who was the Frenchman who proposed the theory that the wind is caused by trees waving their branches? And did he have any other interesting theories?
I know this one. This was Jacques Le Conver, who had another theory about farts were caused by people saying, was that you? Wind orientated. The man was obsessed.
I have here a not very concise real answer. It was probably a Swiss man called Jean Piaget who made various studies into trans... Oh, God, I can't be bothered. It's now time to play the game called Mornington Crescent. First, I have to announce that in response to last week's appeal, we've received nearly 7 letters. Including 6 from a Mrs. Trellis of North Wales. She writes... Wait a minute, let me see. Dear Rabbi Hugo... Why does my typewriter always stick on the letter Y? Yours sincerely, Mrs. Trellis, North Wales. Now, on with the game, teams, and this week we'll be playing Morton's second parallel, which means that if 2 parallel moves follow consecutively, the order of play is automatically reversed. Oh, and since we're in Richmond, I'll reinstate Rule 7. Tim, will you start, please?
Rule 7.
Rule 7.
It fairly easy for us, thank you. Tottenham Court Road.
Putney High Street.
Canal.
The Quadrant.
Ah, nice.
St. Church Street. Thank you.
Richmond Road.
Oh.
Third case more.
Ooh, there's a flutter of panic going on over there now.
Yes, can I clarify, Humph? Rule 7's been reinstated, but we don't have to use it in this game.
Tim's already used it twice.
Nice.
Unintentionally.
And unsuccessfully. No, I'm easy about Rule 7, to tell you the honest truth. Because otherwise, one doesn't want to get pedantic about the thing.
Okay, then,
Brewer. Graham, you're poised. It's a rather dangerous point, I must warn you. Carry on.
I know what you say.
Did you say Brewer Street or was just
a... No, I was going to say Brewer Street, but Humph warned me off that. Yeah. So I'm going to go for Old Compton Street.
Cot Foster's.
For those listening at home, if he had said Brewer Street, it would have meant that... 2 parallel moves followed each other consecutively, and the order of play would have been reversed. And we'd have been here all night.
King Street.
Kingston Church Street.
This is getting quite interesting now.
Pembridge Villas.
Euston Road.
Richmond Road.
Reversed.
Have a quiet word with my partner here.
No conferring.
Too late, we just conferred. I think this is quite an apt moment to put the words Crescent and Mornington together in reverse order. Mornington Crescent.
Oh, not yet. Not yet. Oh, God.
He did. It's now time for a round of limericks. No one really knows where the name Limerick comes from, although some experts believe that it might take its title from a town in Ireland, which is generally associated with meaningless nonsense. Ballykissangel. James, I'm going to furnish you each with an inviting first line, and I'd like you to complete it in Limerick form, taking one line each.
Furnish away.
And Willie, you're going to start. They do say when cooking with chives...
They do say... When cooking with chives, wait till the fire engine arrives.
They tend to explode.
Then you dump your load.
I'm speaking to you from St. Ives.
Okay. Jolly good. Graham, I have an aversion to dill.
I have an aversion to dill. I've been given an anti-dill pill.
Take 3 times a day.
In an unusual way.
It still gives me a bit of a thrill.
Jim, here's a good one for you.
Oh, thank you.
It's said that if Prince Charles eats sage...
It is said that if Prince Charles eats sage, he boils it until it's turned beige.
The sage he likes most...
is Lorenz van der Kirk.
Clever. Who he keeps in a very small cage.
Now, Barry, here's your line. There's something about oregano.
It prevents you from singing soprano.
To hit a top C, take this tip from me.
Wear a truss made of Rusty McConnell.
Well, you probably want to know the score, so I'm going to ask the male voice choir for one more update of the score.
When this final game is over, oh, how happy we shall be.
Is called Just a Minim. It's based on the popular radio panel game hosted by Nicholas Parsons, who, I overhear, is regarded as something of a cult. In this round, I shall ask the teams to sing a popular song of my choosing without repetition, hesitation, repetition, mackerel, or deviation. Those not singing may buzz to challenge. Musical accompaniment will be provided by Colin Sell at the piano. Incidentally, Colin tells me that in 1972, he won Young Musician of the Year. It seems it was a nice little chap and very handy about the house. The song is He's Got the Whole World in His Hands. And Barry, will you start, please?
He's got the whole world in his hands, got the complete planet in his manual extensions. Got the entire globe inside his digital appendages. The overwhelming orb in his, the bits at the end of his arm.
I've just looked at this little box in front of me, and it seems there's been a red light on for some time, which indicates... Indicates that
no
Tim...
No sign of trade, though.
No.
Tim, never know your luck in a strange town, hum.
You said no deviation, hesitation or mackerel, and it smelled pretty fishy to me. Hesitation
no.
And deviation.
No.
I thought it was rather good.
Did
no.
You?
Yeah.
Oh, well, in that case,
thank
I'm
you,
playing
Will.
A different game.
Carry on, Willie.
Oh. Why me? I enjoy it. He's got the little tiny baby in his grip. He's got the elfin person by the neck. He's got his small
challenge,
human.
Challenge. Hold it, there's a challenge.
Why? I can't imagine why.
I think there's a challenge.
What? Repetition.
This thing isn't buzzing very well tonight, I have to tell you.
Repetition. Somebody blew their nose twice.
Actually... I
hope it's...
I did. I heard that. Carry on, Graham.
He's got the little tiny baby in his hands.
Hang about.
Deviation from the tune.
That's a line I clearly remember singing some moments ago.
I consult Colin Sell. He knows more about deviation from the tune than
in
anyone.
In that case... Carry on, Tim.
Oh, no. Where are we... Okay, she's... taken Europe on her feet. She's got orbs in the belfry. Isn't that sweet? She's got
repetition.
You repeat.
You're not meant to.
Repetition.
You're not meant to interrupt me, huh?
I am. You buzzed twice.
No, we both.
We both buzzed once. Nobody buzzed twice.
Graham, I'm going to put you... You did buzz twice, didn't you? I mean, no. I know it may have been a nervous reaction, but you buzzed... You did buzz twice.
I buzzed once, like this.
I'll accept your explanation. It's nearly time to say goodbye.
Oh.
But not before the final decider tiebreak last round, which ends the show. This week it's Biblical Songbook. So I'd like some suggestions, please, for song titles likely to have been big hits in biblical times. Willie, you to start, please.
I'm going to sit right down and write a letter to the Corinthians.
The prodigal son has got his hat on. I need a Hebrew.
There'll be bluebirds, Jehovah. On the White Cliffs of Dover and Gomorrah. Just you wait and see. When they begin to beget.
I'm just a girl that can't say Noah.
Ooh, hark at you.
I'm in the mood for Leviticus.
Epistle while you work.
Well, ladies and gentlemen...
Down at the old burning bush.
Zebedee six trombones.
Well, as the relentless juggernaut of time runs over the final hedgehog of hope... And the last traffic cone of fate is removed from the student bedsit of destiny. I see we've come to the end of the show. So from Sven, the male voice choir, the teams, myself, and the fine people of Richmond upon Thames, goodbye.
Timbrook Taylor, Barry Trier, Graham Garden, and Willie Rushton have been given Silly Things to Do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme was produced by John Naismith. Presents I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the show that stands head and shoulders above the wash basin next to the soap dish. You join us today in the Everyman Theatre amid the elegant charm of Cheltenham. Originally a small Cotswold village, this spa town found favour during the Regency period, and this was largely due to the patronage of the Duke of Wellington, who popularised his unique style of footwear during visits here with Lord Sandal and the Earl of Flip-Flop. In early Victorian times, Cheltenham became a focus for London society, and around 1850 attracted retiring gentlefolk. And that's a fiver more than they usually get. Let me introduce them. They are on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And on my right, Willie Rushton and Tim Brooke Taylor. And the warmest of welcomes, please, for the lady who scores on the desk next to me. The delightful Samantha. Incidentally, Samantha often uses our trips around the country as a chance to nose about after local craftware and ceramics. And she tells me she enjoyed a little potter this afternoon. We'll start off with a round of misquotes. This is a game which grew out of the old Somerset saying, of all the gin joints in all the towns in all the world, you had to walk into Minehead. In it, Keynes, I'd like you please to provide some suggestions of quotations that famous people, alive or dead, would never have said. Barry, will you start, please?
Pablo Picasso. It looks just like it, doesn't it?
Willie.
John Major. Did you see me give my all in Florence, or was it an episode of the Magic Roundabout you missed?
Graham?
Douglas Hogg. Good morning. I'd like a really smart hat.
Tim?
Roy Jenkins. Round the ragged rocks, the ragged rascal.
The Duchess of York. That's enough.
Hugh Graham. Don't do that.
Princess Di, I want to be the queen of clubs.
Forrest Gump. Hello, my name is Forrest Gump, and my mama used to say, Parkeri subjectis et debellare superba.
Wordsworth, what rhymes with hills?
You cleaned that up, didn't you? Oliver Reed, make mine a half.
Marquis de Sade, no need to get nasty.
John Redwood, of course I'm an earthling.
Paula Yates, let's call her Mary.
Well, as Scottish football managers never say, here we are in the second round. It's called One Song to the Tune of Another. It needs little explanation, except to say that the teams have in front of them the words but not the music of a song which is different to another song of which they have neither the music nor the words. The tune of this second song, which is quite unlike the first song, both in words and music, will be played, but without the words to which the teams will substitute the other words they have from the first song, which obviously will have no tune because that's made way for the tune from the other song without its words. Et voila, one song to the tune of another. In fact, it's so simple we've had to make it a bit tougher by letting Colin Sell play the tunes on his piano. Graham, I'd like you to start, please, by singing the words of I'm the Urban Spaceman to the tune of Memory.
I'm the urban spaceman, baby. I've got speed, I've got everything I need. I'm the urban spaceman, baby. I can fly. I'm a supersonic guy. I don't need pleasure, I don't feel pain. If you were to knock me down, I'd just get up again. I'm the urban spaceman, I've got hairs on my chest. I never depressed.
Okay, Barry, will you sing the words of Come Into the Garden, Maud, to the tune of The Teddy Bear's Picnic?
Come into the garden, Maud, for the black bat night has flown. Come into the garden, Maud, I'm here at the gate alone. I'm here at the gate alone, and the woodbine spices are wafted abroad, and the musk, the roses blow, for a breeze of morning moves, and the planets are blown.
is on high, beginning to faint in the light that she loves on a bed of daffodil sky. To faint in the light of the sun she loves, to faint in the light and to die. Come, 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 come into the garden, Maud for the black, that night is lone. Come into the garden, Maud, I'm here. At the gate alone, I'm here at the gate alone, queen of the rosebud garden of girls, come hither.
Okay, your turn, Willie, now, and I'd like you to sing the words of Great Balls of Fire to the tune of the Blue Danube.
You shake my nerves and you rattle my brain. Too much love drives a man insane. You broke my will, but what a thrill. Goodness gracious, great balls of fire. I laughed and laughed, but I thought it was funny. You came along and moved me, honey. I changed my mind, this love is fine. Goodness gracious, great balls of fire.
And finally, Tim, would you please sing the words of Relax by Frankie Goes to Hollywood to the tune of Danny Boy.
Relax, don't do it when you want to go to it. Relax, don't do it when you want to come. Relax, don't do it when you want a socket to it. Relax, don't do it when you want to come. But shoot it in the right direction. You're making it your intention.
Your glasses, please.
Live those dreams. Scheme those schemes. Go to it. Hit me. Hit me, hit me, hit me with those laser beams.
Not a dry person in the house.
Okay, well, it's now time to play a round of sound charades. This is similar to the old parlour game of charades, in which the players mime film, book and play titles for the others to guess. However, in our version, as you probably know, the panellists are permitted the use of their mouths. Recently, we experimented with a similar game called smell charades. But we were forced to evacuate the studio after Willie did Animal Farm.
In stereo, be fair.
And then we attempted feel charades, but Barry tried to do Lady Chatterley's Lover and we had to call the police. Okay, Tim and Willie, you're to start, and your title will shortly be broadcast to our theatre audience via the digitally enhanced 3D multi-screen colour surround quadraphonic laser-projected hologram display, so generously funded by our hosts. And here's... Here's the mystery voice for listeners at home.
The Nun's Story. The Nun's Story.
Okay.
Three words. It's definitely a film. I don't know if it's anything else.
Might have been a book.
Yeah.
If not, there was probably a book of the film.
Okay, here it goes.
Now, listen, here's a funny thing. There were these three monks. tell a lie. Tell a lie, there were two.
There were two. On the wag.
Yes, that's there were two there were.
Is this true, sister?
No.
Is that it?
Yep.
Ah.
It's the lying nun.
It's a nun spinning a bit of a yarn here, I think.
Time's up.
Has it got the word the in the title?
You're on to it, Graham.
That's a word we weren't certain about. It could have been A, actually, but I think it's the.
We think it's the.
Well,
yeah.
We'll be going over to racing from Folkestone in a few moments.
25 seconds.
We think it's the nun's story.
Yeah.
Right, it's your turn, Barry and Graham. Your title's now going up on the laser display, and here again is the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Auntie's Sporting Bloomers. Auntie's Sporting Bloomers.
Okay, carry on. Barry and Graham.
TV programme. And it's three words. And it goes like this. Are you dead? Kids at school tell me that your sister Muriel played for Arsenal.
Well, they're right, Gavin, she did. She did indeed play for Arsenal.
I can't believe that, Dad.
Well, it may be hard to believe, but let me prove it to you. Look what I've got here in this drawer. Look at these.
Gosh.
Yeah. As strong as he, reinforced gusset. Go faster, flap, and a little. And a little Arsenal logo on the leg.
What's a gusset, Dad?
As a rugby player, I believe.
Well. I'll never forget that, Dad. The end.
Do you say our sister Muriel scored for Arsenal?
Played for.
Played for. Oh,
played for.
Pity I had a different picture altogether.
Oh, well, go with that, then.
If it was Muriel Wogan, it'd be Wogan's Bloomers or whatever.
Auntie,
I've been on that and I can't remember what it's called.
Auntie's Bloomers.
Auntie's Bloomers.
Nearly. No. Auntie, three words.
Auntie's Bloomers 2.
Three words. I say, they haven't got it, Humph, have they, really?
No. Shall I give them a...
Auntie's Sporting
More. Yeah.
The next round is called Unhelpful Advice, and it's based on a game played by our friends in the traffic news department, which they call Stagger Your Journey. This week, teams, I'd like you to suggest pieces of advice that would be totally unhelpful to a school sex education class. Tim, will you start, please?
Now, who can tell me why in a packet of jelly babies, the boy jelly babies weigh more? Yes, that's right, they're taller.
Barry.
Now, look. Let me point out, you test these things first with a pin.
Now, this is what happens when a bird or a bee perches on a lavatory seat.
Home vasectomy can be fun.
Now, children, size isn't everything.
And this bit is known as the Volvo.
Following on from Graham, think of the human body as a car. And you might say to yourselves, why is the ignition so near the exhaust? Now...
If you're looking for a lively aphrodisiac, you cannot overdo syrup of figs.
The best protective is a condor. Or any other large bird of prey.
An extremely popular form of foreplay is to strike your partner on the back of the head with a euphonium. Well, it worked for Jimmy Edwards.
School's out. Oh, sorry.
Okay. Right. The next round is Cheddar Gorge, and it's just one in a long list of games from various parts of the country. There's Humber Bridge, a card game played in vintage motor cars. Windsor Great Park, where the best player wins a really great park. And, of course, on Saturday nights, the young men of Norwich regularly have a go at the Norfolk Broads. OK, teams, I'd like you please to provide one word each in turn in the style of motor racing commentator Murray Walker. The object is never to arrive at a full stop. If you hear this, it means I judge that a sentence has been completed. If you hear this... it means Uncle Tom's been spotted entering the bull after closing time. To complicate the round unnecessarily, I'll give each of you a special word to include, drawn from Mr. Walker's unique vocabulary. Tim, yours is sensational.
Thank you very much. Most kind.
Graham, yours is helmet. Barry, correction. And Willie, pits.
I do not.
Okay, who's going to start? Tim, you start.
Here we are in the outside of the sensational current...
I'm doing David Frost.
Current Grand...
What?
It's French for big.
Oh, Grand.
Grand. Helmet. Of the
next
and
only
correction last.
What?
Last night I saw pits. Oh.
What do you say?
How does he keep his job?
I don't know.
All of the next lap or on reflection, I am sure correction. Sometimes I see other things in the pits.
It's now time to play a round called Sporting Outtakes. But before we do, let's just take some time to recall all those truly great British sporting successes of the last few decades. And on with the round. Okay. Okay, teams, I shall now play in a selection of sporting outtakes, which I'd like you to identify, please. And the first one is for you, Barry.
Linford Christie putting his shorts on. Or packing his lunch, as it sometimes.
Graham, here's yours.
I think that's quite an easy one, isn't it? It's the badminton horse trials.
Here's one for you, Tim.
know this. It's Damon Hill practicing on the streets of Monaco a week too early.
And finally, Willie, here's one for you.
Be an elderly recording of Dennis Compton coming on at the nursery end with his Chinaman.
Right, well, our next game is called Just a Minim, a musical version of Just a Minute, in which the teams attempt a selection of favourite songs without repetition, hesitation, repetition, deviation, anthrax or repetition. The team not singing may buzz to challenge. Musical accompaniment will be provided by Colin Sell at the piano. Incidentally, we were surprised to learn that back in the 70s, Colin once produced 10cc. But the doctor needed a bigger sample and I asked him to try again with the tap running. Barry and Graham. Barry and Graham, I'd like you to start us off, please. And the song is Gilly Gilly, Ossen Pfeffer, Katzenellen, Bogan by the Sea.
Now there's a tiny house, there's a maisonette, by a very small stream,
by a minute trickle.
It's a repetition of there's a.
Oh, spirit of the game.
Call me Clement Freud if you like, but I've got to stick.
I can't allow that, Tim, because I inadvertently turned your buzzer off. So carry on, whoever's doing it now.
Where a lovely lass,
whence a comely maid,
had a delightful dream.
An exotic fantasy.
And her fantasy...
Challenge from Willie.
Yes. Whatever he said twice. I think it was fantasy.
You better carry on, Willie.
Oh. And her imagined delight came true. And her nightmare bore fruit.
Challenge.
Chaos.
In F. Quite unexpectedly. Oh, have you judged?
Yeah, go on.
In Gilly, Golly, Ossen Pfeffer, Katzenellen, Bogan, by the sea. She was out one day.
This girl was outside the room.
Where the tulips grow.
In a place where some flowers sprout.
When a handsome lad.
When a... horribly good-looking fellow.
Challenge from Mary.
Gross hesitation.
He's a big lad.
I thought it was artistic expression.
So. Yes.
Go on, Tim.
Stop to say hello.
I said that. Oh, pause. Our dear bonjour.
And before she knew,
and prior to her knowing all about it,
he kissed her tenderly.
Challenge from Kevin.
We finished, huh?
Who's on there? Deviation.
Whoever wrote these labels has got terrible handwriting. No, the challenge from Mr. Graham.
Deviation.
What?
Well, what's her tenderly?
Oh, mind your own business is a phrase that is called by Graham.
Jolly good. Well, it's very nearly the...
Is this getting too glossy?
Well, it's very nearly the end of the show, but there's just time to squeeze in a round of Banker's Film Club. So, teams, while Samantha and I nip out with my flexible friend to make a large withdrawal, I'd like...
Dear, oh dear.
I'd like suggestions, please, of film titles likely to delight an audience of bankers and the like.
The
Splendor of the Bank of England. The Madness of Eddie George.
North by Nat West. Starring the Lone Ranger and Tonto.
A famous historical romp, Dow Jones. Starring Albert F.D.
The Snows of Kilimanjaro Bank. Bring me the statement of Alfredo Garcia.
Tessa the D'Urbervilles. Nick Leeson's tragic story, Back to the Futures.
Oh. The Grapes of Rothschild.
New horror film, Croak, in which a bank is invaded by hundreds of frogs going credit, credit, credit. Withdrawal and I. Night Safe on Elm Street.
Sharon. Debit Winger and Bette Midland in A Star is Overdrawn.
Sharon Stone in Basic Interest Rate.
They died with their coots on.
And so, as the qualcast mower of time cuts through the electric flex of destiny, I notice we've come to the end of the show. So from the team, Samantha, myself, and the good people of Cheltenham, goodbye.
Brooke Taylor, Barry Trier, Graham Garden and Willie Rushton have been given Silly Things to Do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme was produced by John Naismith. I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue. You join us once again at the Everyman Theatre in Cheltenham, where we've attracted a capacity audience of some 700 odd people. It's here in Cheltenham that racegoers gather every March to enjoy the Gold Cup, which I understand is run over hurdles by four-year-old Arabs. A mere stone's throw away is the world-famous Cheltenham Ladies' College, where the mother of our own Tim Brooke Taylor actually taught gym for several years before noticing the little chap had enrolled at the wrong school. And excelling as the college does in the tutelage of well-bred young ladies, there are many who would desperately like to gain entrance. Let me introduce four of them. There on my right, Willie Rushton and Tim Brooke Taylor. And on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And please welcome the lady with a keen eye to note who's furthest out in front, the delightful Samantha. Our first round is entitled Ancient Radio Times. Flicking through some old magazines the other day, I came across an edition of the Radio Times dated 500 BC. As the doctor was ready to see me, I was sadly unable to read it. But from the front cover, I could tell it was a special ancient Greek edition. So, teams, I'd like you to suggest, please, some titles of TV and radio programs likely to have been listed inside. And, Willie, will you start, please?
The Hammer House of Horace.
Theseus, your life?
David Jason and the Argonauts, it only fools and wooden horses. Menelaus behaving badly.
Oedipus, blind date, starring Scylla and Charybdis.
Homer and away.
Hector's house.
Takes you back, doesn't it?
How do they do that? Juno? They think it's all of it.
Educating Archimedes.
For some of your older listeners.
I was going to mention Aeneid Blyton, but I couldn't bring myself to do it.
So 9 o'clock Zeus and Medusa at 10.
Another chance to see Monty Parthenon, starring John Cleese, Androcles, and Pericles.
Now that's going back on an equally old show, The Goddies with Bill Odysseus. Wish You Were Hera?
This Morning with Castor and Pollux.
And now over to the Wembley Arena for the third day of the Elgin Marbles.
Also, midweek Socrates from Wembley. Wooden horse jumping from Hickstead. And our cricketers on their minor tour of Zimbabwe.
Film 450 BC with Barry Gorgon.
Featuring Acropolis Now.
And the Sirens of the Lambs.
I've got to interrupt this flow of inspiration. Because we have a second round, and it's a musical round called Pickup Song, in which the teams will sing along to some popular recordings. DJ Samantha is poised at the gramophone with a selection of discs. At a given point, she'll cause the modulated frequency wave of the recorded sound signal to reduce to zero by a process known as turning the volume down. And I defy you to find a double entendre in that. If when the disc returns, teams, you're within a... the Guardian sub-editor wrote this. It says a giant's crotchet. If when the disc returns, you're within a gnat's crotchet of the original, I'll be awarding points, and points mean prizes. Oh, dear. I've got to give this up. I'm becoming a control freak. This week's prize comes from the Findus Dermatology Convenience Range. It's this boil in a bag. Okay, Barry, I'd like you to start by accompanying Chuck Berry singing No Particular Place to Go.
Riding along in my automobile, my baby beside me at the wheel. I stole a kiss at the turn of a mile, my curiosity running wild. Cruising and playing the radio with no particular place to go.
He's over 60 now, you know.
Riding along my automobile, was anxious to tell her the way I feel.
He wasn't at the beginning.
Angelina whispered in my ear, cuddling more and driving slow, with no particular place to go. Oh, man.
It was Jan's crotchet after all. Your turn, Willie. I'd like you to accompany Adam Faith singing What Do You Want?
What do you want if you don't want money? What do you want if you don't want gold? Say what you want and I'll give it to you, darling. Wish you wanted my love, baby. What do you want if you don't want ermine? What do you want if you don't want pearls? Say what you want and I'll give it you, darling. Wish you wanted my love, baby. Well, I'm offering you this heart of mine, but all you do is play it cool. What do you want? Oh, boy, you're making a fool of me. Oh, one of these days, you need my kissing. One of these days. Ah.
Slowing down as the years go by.
Your turn, Graham. Would you please accompany Ben E. King singing Stand By Me?
When the night has come and the land.
And the land.
Keep up. Keep up. Is the only light I can see.
Don't drop it out.
No, I won't be afraid. No, I won't be afraid. Just as long you stand by me. So darling, darling, stand by me. Oh, stand by me. Oh, stand by me, stand by me. If the sky we look upon.
Finally, Tim, would you please accompany Blur singing Country House?
Batman. So the story begins.
City dweller, successful fella, thought to himself, oops, I've got a lot of money. Caught in a rat race, terminal lane. I'm a professional cynic, but my heart's not in it. I'm paying the price of living life at the legal limit. Caught in the centuries, anxiety. Yes, it preys on him, preys on him. He's getting thin. So he lives in a house, a very big house in the country. Watching afternoon repeats and the food he eats in the country.
Well, we don't have to ask who won that one. Wasn't any of these four. Moving on, we come to a new round called Salesman of the Century, which has nothing to do with Nicholas Parsons. But then who does? In it, I'd like the team members to take the roles of long-forgotten characters from history. Oh, my acting in that bit. They'll have to deal with a visit from two door-to-door salesmen trying to sell them something they never knew that they needed. Okay, Tim and Willie, I'd like you to assume the identity of Mr. and Mrs. Noah. And Barry and Graham, you can be door-to-door salesmen selling dusters.
Bing bong.
Sorry, I was downstairs checking the fish.
You met Mrs. Noah, have you?
Morning.
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 Morning. We're on a scheme. we got a card. Here's my card. You can see it's got a picture of somebody on it. And we wondered if we could sell you any dusters at all.
No, thank you.
Well, we don't just have dusters.
Oh, no. We've got oven gloves.
Yeah.
By the brace.
What?
Mop heads.
What use
lovable
would they...
mop heads we've got.
People keep thinking we say mopeds. We have to clarify. We have to clarify that. Lovely garden you've got. Never seen one on an ark before.
What use would they be to us, though?
Well, a mess. I mean, let's... I don't want to be too indelicate, but...
You just have been.
But you have a lot of clearing up to do after your animals. Twice as much as if you only had one of each.
We've got sponges and chamois.
We've got a nice chamois. We've got two nice chamois.
Sure.
We use the hedgehogs. You can buff something up lovely with a hedgehog.
Yeah, we've got some nice lemon cleaning liquid. You'll have the cleanest lemons on the Seven Seas.
Those elephants must be a trial.
And
Japheth handles the elephants.
Who does?
Well, that's we'd rather offense, isn't it?
We'd rather not talk about it.
He must be very tall.
He stands on a giraffe. It's.
You need stocking up. It's going to be a long time to Ararat.
40 days and 40 nights. We've got the timetable.
Well, there's points failure at Peterborough.
No, thank you.
Squeegee.
Right, Barry and Graham, it's your turn. I'd like you to assume the role of Mr. and Mrs. Genghis Khan. Tim and Willie, I'd like you to be the salesman, this time selling desk tidies.
Bing bong.
Hello.
Would this be Mr. or Mrs. Khan I'm speaking to?
You sounded like a salesman in another life.
used to be, before I went in for the pillaging and raping. Genghis, and this is the good lady, Madge.
Hello.
Well, I think it's you, Mr. Genghis, who'll be more interested in the desk tidy than your good lady, because in your line of business, pillaging and raping and looting, I mean, you would find it a boon to be able to put your hands on your paper clips without unnecessary bother, I'd imagine.
The little woman, Madge, God bless her, she looks after my study and tidying items.
That's right, Geng.
Do you use spears at all? Because we have the Acme pencil sharpener as part of our... And the sellotape, you can cover up all sorts of...
all the sellotape? What's sellotape do then, you silver-tongued charmer?
She's taking a fancy to you, Reg. You can be in her beard in seconds.
They haven't grabbed us yet, have they, Madge?
No.
Oh, well, off to another house then.
Our next round is called Notes and Queries. Glancing at my copy of The Guardian the other day, Teams, I was pleased to read an interesting question and answer section which they call Snots and Queasy. So with this in mind, I'd like you please to pool your considerable knowledge and to provide answers to the following niggling little questions. Graham, you first. Do animals or birds ever refer to each other by name?
Well, yes, but only if they're called woof, meow, or moo.
Well, the answer is no, but some are able to recognize one another. And I know how they do it, the disgusting creatures. Tim, why should you never put ripe bananas next to cut flowers?
Because they stick out like sore thumbs.
Thank you, sir.
I'll tell you why, because it's interesting. Ripe bananas give off a special gas, ethene. It's called ethene or ethene, which speeds up the ripening in other fruit and vegetation.
Gosh.
Willie, why do the clergy wear dog collars?
Why does the Archbishop of Canterbury worry sheep?
The boring answer is that a visiting Roman Catholic order first wore them in the 1840s, and the look caught on.
Barry,
what's the best thing to do if attacked by an aggressive dog?
Fake an orgasm.
Well, the answer, believe it or not, is you attempt to force its legs apart sideways.
Whatever works for you, huh? And then make a wish.
Excuse me, sir, what are you doing with that dog?
Make a wish.
No wonder it's foaming at the mouth.
Don't you want to know why?
Yes.
We're a gog.
Well, it pulls apart the ribs and causes breathing difficulties.
Oh, dear. Preferred mine, actually.
Okay, here are some more for anyone to answer. Do giraffes take special precautions during thunderstorms?
Yes. They dash down to the chemist and buy an enormous packet of three.
The official answer is no. Why are eggs egg-shaped?
Never mind that. How do hens know the size of egg cup?
Well, the actual answer is that the curve provides the strongest resistance to outside forces.
What outside?
Why do men always do the cooking at barbecues?
Because women, bless them, are absolutely incapable of burning meat properly.
Well, the answer is that it's been suggested that it revives their caveman instincts. Is it true that cows sitting down is a portent of rain?
Possibly, but it's not as reliable a portent as a pharmacy full of giraffes.
Well, for those who are ever tempted to get into the field and make the cow stand up, I have to tell you the answer is no. It's now time to play the game called Mornington Crescent. I noticed from my in-tray that we've received literally a postcard from a Mrs. Trellis of North Wales, who sends her observations on Euro 96, and she writes, "Dear Acker, hats off to the boy Gascoigne. He's done good. If the BBC had any sense, he'd be back chairing University Challenge." Instead of that Jeremy Beadle. Yours sincerely, Mrs. Trellis. On with the game now, which this week pits the team's wits against the new Garry Gasparov Pentium computer program. As this works on a five-move cycle, I will interrupt after every fourth move with the computer's choice. Understood?
Yep.
I'm glad somebody does. Okay, Tim, will you start us off, please?
Platt's Lane.
Priory Road.
Old Compton Street. This sounded good. It was. I'm not surprised you didn't notice that. How good it was.
Empire Way.
Well, the computer comes in now with Moscow Road.
Moscow Road. Lavender Hill.
Kildare Terrace.
Euston Road.
Arnos Grove.
And the computer in again with Volga Street.
Archway.
Would that be the Volga Street in E11 or in Wimbledon?
Well, both as far as I know.
All right.
Pembridge Villas.
You're not a discerning audience, are you? How well do you know this game?
Better than the computer so far.
Queensway. Thank you. A little pocket of knowledgeable persons.
Barrett? No.
Some of them with their teeth in it, didn't they?
Earls.
Not their own.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Are they conferring, Hump?
Mm-hmm.
Who?
Them.
The audience.
So, not barons, but Earl's Court.
Yeah.
Earl's Court.
And the computer's come up with St. Peter's Square.
You can
Hammersmith.
Yes, quite right. It's Lonsdale Road.
Talgarth Road.
I think, Willie, you've got him.
I think so.
What? Tell her.
No.
Mornington Crescent.
Yeah. Adjudication, Hump, please.
Well, I don't know.
Fair enough.
If we go into all that.
I think we accept that.
If we go into all that, we'll be here all night, so... Now time for a round of limericks, the five-line nonsense poems loved by literally tens of people. Themes, I shall furnish you each with a first line rich in poetic possibility, which I'd like you to continue taking one line each, please. Tim. For a laugh, I dressed up as a bee.
For a laugh, I dressed up as a bee. Blame Anthea Turner, not me.
She was dressed as a rose.
But I'm not into those.
So I stung the poor cow on the knee.
Barry, here's one for you. I once had a fully trained moth.
I once had a fully trained moth. Trained, strangely enough, for the cloth.
He did one loop-the-loop.
From pulpit to soup.
Garçon, there's a priest in my broth.
Right, Barry, here's yours. As a child, I was troubled by nits.
Which I caught when we stayed at the Ritz.
We moved to the Savoy.
Where a rogue Savaloy.
Leapt up and thrilled Granny to bits.
We've now reached the point in the show that nobody's been waiting for. It's time for the teams to announce the late arrivals at the Cheesemakers' Ball. So while Samantha nips out to enjoy a mouthful of Leicester, I'd like... I'd like you, Willie, to start us off, please.
The Forts and their son, Rock.
The mother and father of all Italian cheeses, Mar and Parmesan. Welcome.
Mr. and Mrs. Zola and their son, Emil.
Yes. And will you welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. Shire and their tall, thin son, Lankyshire.
Please silence and grovel a bit for the family, Ooh.
Ooh.
And their daughter, poor Sal.
And from Yorkshire, oh, they've gone, Edam. It's cabaret time.
No, no. Oh, good heavens. Is that the time?
With a tribute to Mozzarella Fitzgerald. And Miss Muffet's going to do a strip while eating curds. Why?
And from the West Country, will you welcome Mr. and Mrs. Hershey's? And their son, Jed Hershey's. Not to mention Farmer and Mrs. Brown and their ploughman, Zlunt. Old biblical name.
Also in the cabaret, Stilton John will be playing the Harry Limeswell theme.
Will you welcome Mr. and Mrs. Jones and their aggressive son who swears a lot, Blue Vinny?
Always, always pleasant to welcome the Scream Crackers and their son, Jacob.
Duke and Duchess of Gloucester have come in together? Oh, yes, the double Gloucesters.
Let me give you a toasty. Must say this carefully. My old Dutch. Thank you. Your hats and goats, cheese.
Well, here's a funny thing.
About bloody time.
They can't see it at home, huh?
No, I see that the score's... No, listen to this, because it is interesting. Because the scores are even.
Oh.
Which means that not only have we had an excitingly close contest, but also that the last half hour has been a complete waste of time. So, teams, we'll have to play the tie-break. I'd like you, please, using only your skill and judgment, to complete the following sentence in the most apt or amusing way. The National Lottery makes me feel like a millionaire because...
I'm a director of Camelot.
Elder. Well, as the delicate mayfly of time collides with the speeding windscreen of fate, and the angry wasp of destiny flies up the trouser leg of despair, I notice it must be the end of the program, and indeed the series. We'll be back again in the autumn, but in the meantime, from the team, Samantha, myself, and the fine people of Cheltenham, goodbye.
Goodbye.
Brooke Taylor, Barry Trier, Graham Garden and Willie Rushton have been given silly things to do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme was produced by John Naismith.